Evening, everyone. Welcome to this evening's program being hosted by the Press Institute of India. I'm Sashi Naya here. I'm delighted to welcome our speaker this evening, Nivedita Lewis. Nivedita, thank you very much for being here this evening. I think it makes it special for you because today's is Madras Day, 382 years celebration of the founding of the city. Before I introduce Nivedita and she runs through her presentation, let me, for the benefit of those who would like to know a little bit about the history of our city, say a few words. Chennai had its beginnings in a fortified warehousing settlement set up 382 years ago by the British East India Company on a stretch of what is called No Man's Sand, and from which today you find the city's leading roads, the Mount Road or Annasalai and the Punamali High Road, the arterial roads. It was there at Fort St. George that the foundations of modern India were laid. In 1639, the small fishing hamlet of Madras Patnam was chosen as a settlement by English merchants, primarily because of the easy availability of cheap, long cloth. The lure of trade in exotic spices and precious stones drew the Portuguese to India in the early 16th century. The Dutch, the Danes, and the French soon followed. Desperate to get a share of the spoils, the English soon arrived. They came as traders, but stayed on to found an empire. However, they did not land on the sandy beaches of the Coromandel coast first. After establishing a factory in Surat in Gujarat, they set one up in Machilipatnam in Andhra Pradesh. And in 1626, a fort and factory in Armagao, which is also known as Durgarajapatnam, north of Pulikat. For all that, Surat, Machilipatnam, and Armagao proved unsuitable for trade, especially with the Dutch and the Portuguese behind their backs all the time. It was such a state of affairs that led Francis Day, an adventurous officer of the English East India Company, to explore the Coromandel coast. It was he who came upon a small fishing hamlet or kuppam called Madras Patnam. The area of No Man's Sand was protected on the south and west by the Kuam and Elambo rivers, and on the east by the sea. It also provided excellent long cloth, and what more, the cloth was cheaper by 20% than found anywhere else. Francis Day's negotiations with the local Naiks, the Damarla brothers, Venkatappa and Ayyappa, who were the deputies of the Raja of Chandragiri, the Vijayanagar monarch, led to his obtaining a grant to lease a sandy spot that was gradually to become a thriving center of the East India Company, the first seat of British power in India. Beri Timanna or Timappa is said to be the Dubash or Do Basha, or two languages, who brokered the deal. Descendants of Timappa continue to live in Chennai, and I have met a few of them some years ago when we started celebrations of Madras Day and Madras Week. Historical records show that the grant was obtained on August 22nd, 1639, 382 years ago today. And on February 20th, 1540, the following year, Day and Andrew Cogan, his boss, stationed at Machilipatnam, together with an entourage of assistants, clerks, soldiers, and builders, arrived at Madras Patnam to begin work on the fort in the settlement. Work on the inner part of the fort was completed on April the 23rd, 1640, St. George's Day. And it was perhaps the reason why the fort was named after the patron saint of England. According to city historian S. Mutaya, sadly no more, the settlement was named Chennapatnam after the Damarla brothers' father, who was called Chenna, at their request, and a bastion was built to protect the new colony. So from a small trading post, Madras became the headquarters of the British military and administrative power on the East Coast. And it was here in the city that the seeds of empire were planted, not Calcutta. It was in Madras that India's first English school and India's first municipal corporation came up. Indeed, the English had settled here 25 years ago before they reached Bombay and 50 years before Calcutta. Many of the nationwide systems that are in place today owe their origins to planners who lived within the walls of this fort. But sadly, many are hardly remembered today. Whether it was governance, record keeping, civic establishments, or jurisprudence, whether it was education, engineering, or medicine, or the Indo-Saracenic architectural form or green havens within a city, Chennai started them all, and the rest of India followed. Gradually, as trade developed around the fort, the city grew expansively. The pace of growth, as we all know, has quickened after independence, and nevertheless, the infrastructure and living and breathing space we find here are far better than most of the other major cities in India. So that's the brief background for you. I can go on and on, but I have Nivedita Lewis, who's waiting to make her presentation. Nivedita is one of the young pillars or catalysts, if I might call her, who's taken the baton forward from people like S. Muthiah, Vincent D'Souza, Sriram, and others. And we are happy that we have youngsters like here showing others the way to conserve and preserve heritage, to research, and also come up with books. She calls herself a social and feminist historian. Nivedita has authored books on the women pioneers of the Madras presidency and on comparative archaeology and material culture in Tamil. She was content curator for the ILSAI Museum exhibition at the Government Museum in Egmore and for the Chennai Museum application launched by the museum. She has conducted several heritage walks in the city, including heritage tours for school and college children, and has spoken at various fora on the Wonder Women of Madras. And we shall, of course, wait to listen to her today, because some of those Wonder Women include foreign women, which is the subject this evening, and of course, their contribution to Tamil society, including women in Tamil politics and women in science. Nivedita, over to you. We look forward to your presentation, and I'm sure you'll make it memorable for us on Madras Day.
Thank you so much, Shashi sir. It was a wonderful introduction that you gave to the city that we all call our home today. So welcoming everyone to this lecture. Good evening, one and all. It has been a very, very happy moment for me every year to be part of the Press Institute of India's organized Madras Day lectures. I really look forward to these lectures each year. And this year, I think I'm presenting something that has not been touched upon a lot by historians of yore. So we'll be talking about the foreign women and the contributions that they have done to this Madras presidency. So I have been repeatedly telling that unless and until women themselves wield their pens and start writing their own history, the history of women will never be told or retold. So it is high time that women here, the youngsters mostly, we are depending on you to start writing your own stories, your own history. So with that, let us go to today's presentation. Is my screen visible, sir?
Yes. Yes. It is.
Okay. So I would like to call these women the Firangi women, because that is how they have been called. They have several other names by which the people of the land used to call them, but then the Firangi has stuck to me. They've done a lot of contributions to Tamil Nadu, to Madras presidency in various fields. But when we talk about foreign women, the generally misunderstood norm is that they were all missionary women who came to convert people. So I think this lecture today will make people rethink what these women were actually doing in a land that was more than 3,000 miles away from their own homeland. So women, most of the women flocked to India only to find husbands for them, mostly. The European men who came here were mostly deployed in the military. They were working as officers in the ministry. We had, they worked as administrative officers. They worked as ministers. They worked as judges. They worked as lawyers. They worked in the police. They worked in the army. They worked everywhere. And these men who came initially, say for instance, the Portuguese and the other people, when they came, the initial Europeans, they could not find enough women to marry simply because women refused to come all the way from their respective countries to a land which was unknown to them, a very hostile land, taken given its climatic conditions, given the people who lived here, most women did not prefer to come here. But then, this is one wonderful book by Anne de Courcy, The Fishing Fleet, which states that most of these women came here as the fishing fleet. These women were called the fishing fleet because they came husband hunting here. So every year when there is a season, usually when the British royals, right from the British royals, everyone from the English gentry, they used to introduce the women to that particular season and check if that woman is marketable or if she's saleable in the marriage market. And when women pathetically could not win over suitors back in England, most of these women flocked to India looking for husbands here. Some of them succeeded, some of them failed. We know there have been a lot of such people who have succeeded, and they predominantly did mostly the work of a homemaker. But then what about the other women? You know, we hear about a lot of doctors, we hear about pioneering women, we hear about path-breaking women who have done something to this society. So here I present the first person that I'm going to be talking to today, Mrs. Klug, Frieda Schulz Klug. That is the name that we come across. I think our revered historian, Mr. S. Muthaya, has mentioned about her. He has written that Mrs. Klug started Madras' first exhibition movie theater. And more than that, apart from that, I didn't find any references about this Mrs. Klug. Mrs. Klug remained an enigma to me until about 2 weeks ago. When I started looking around for her, I found this beautiful picture of hers where she has signed her name and she has dated it. When it is being said, the first movie theater of South India was started in the year 1913, and that is Electric Theater, the one that you are seeing here. It is said to be the first cinema house of South India. They've also put up a banner there. And this cinema theater is still being flaunted as the city's first movie theater. But apart from this, there has been a movie theater that came in earlier than this. This was in 1913, which place is now, the place is now the General Post Office now, it's part of the GPO. But you find this interesting advertisement in the Madras Mail, dated April 17, 1911. It is about a movie theater called the Bioscope. And just look at the tagline under it, opened permanently in Madras. So the person, whoever opened this theater, they were very sure that they're opening something that is permanent in this city. And it mentions there is a continuous show that is given from 6 to 11 every evening, and anybody is permitted or admission anytime, and the last performance starts at 9:30. So this particular advertisement clearly mentions the name Proprietress Mrs. Klug underneath. So who is this Klug? So when I looked for this Mrs. Klug, I could find that she was one very interesting person, a Hungarian by birth, who was brought up in Italy. She lived in Turin. She came to India in the year 1911 to start a theater here, a 6 months venture. Unfortunately, the venture failed for whatever reasons. She left Madras for good and she went back to Italy. So what about this Miss Klug? Who was she and why did she call herself Mrs. Klug when she clearly wasn't Mrs. Klug? So Georgetown's Popham's Broadway, door number 16. That is the address that is mentioned. 1911, Madras' first movie theater, which was called the Broadway Bioscope, was opened. And when a historian, Stephen Putnam Hugh, he writes about this theater and he clearly mentions, Most of the historians have avoided mentioning about the exhibitions, the movie exhibitions, which is the beginning of the movie era. History speaks about big, big directors. It speaks about huge stars. It speaks about blockbuster movies, but it never speaks about these kind of movie exhibitions that have been happening elsewhere in the erstwhile Madras presidency. So in August 14, 2010, I think he has written an article in The Hindu where he clearly mentions that he has no idea about where Mrs. Kluge came from and where she had disappeared. So who is this enigmatic person, Mrs. Kluge? And the answer is given by a social historian by name Monica Del Asta, who writes an article in the same year, 2010, which she names Frida Kluge, Pearl White, and Women Film Pioneers. And in this article, she clearly mentions that Frida Kluge Schulz was someone who belonged to Turin in Italy, and she started her own distribution company in the year 1910. We also know that Hungarian by birth, Frida, she initially was a person who worked with a movie company, a distribution company called the Schulz Distribution Company, when she was 22 years old. And there is a movie magazine by name La Vita Cinematografica, which clearly mentions her as the world agent of Helios Studios from Italy. And in 1911, Mrs. Kluge came to Madras. So why did people come to Madras to open a movie theater? And why did people throng this place? People came to this place because they knew it had greener pastures. We all know that the same movie magazine, Movie World Preview, it clearly mentions that there were a lot of Europeans who wanted to show Indian cinema because they thought they could earn a lot of money in the East. So in the same advertisement dated April 17, we see that there are three kinds of tickets that are being issued here. One for 1 rupee, one for 8 anas, and one for 4 anas. So there were clearly three different kinds of tickets being issued. And the theater boasts about being airy. It has electricity, it has fans, and it also has lights, electric lights and fans. So obviously electric theater was not the first theater that had electric fans and lights. It was this bioscope which had the first electric lights and fans 2 years earlier to our electric theater. And in April 19, 1911, Madras Mail clearly mentions that this movie theater provided permanent entertainment for the entertainment starved people of Madras, which was unlike any other European city, which had a lot of other kinds of entertainments for people to look on. And in sometime around October 1911, this theater shut shop. And we find that Mrs. Frida Kluge, or Miss Frida Kluge, she went back to Italy. And from there, we trace her in another magazine, the Movie World Review, where we see that she has gone to the United States. She stays for three or four more years in the United States, and she leaves the United States in 1915. She starts forging business partnerships and business relationships. I'm reminding you again, she's hardly 23 when she's doing all this. Imagine a woman doing all this more than 120 years ago, coming to a place in like India, trying to open a theater here, trying to market movies here, and then going back empty-handed, probably I should say, and then moving over to the United States. And she called herself Mrs. Kluge because in April 1915, there is a magazine article which clearly mentions that she got recently married to Mr. Schulz. So why did she call herself as Mrs. Kluge in Madras? You know, anybody can guess. Probably that's because of the social, moral, the situation that was existing in a place like Madras those days. And she was the leader of Ambrosio Films. We find that she was the leader of that company. And this company was selling movies to the Universal Studios, which we all know. She was also a movie critic because she has mentioned very clearly that the Italian movies and the European movies were far better than the movies that were made by the American movie world. And Movie Picture World magazine mentions her as the woman who conquered American cinema. Imagine being called the woman who conquered American cinema when you are 19, when you are 22 years old, when you have started a venture in India, when you have started a venture in Madras presidency, which backfires, you close shop, you go to the US. And was she able to succeed in the US? And I think she was able to succeed to an extent, because from what we read about her, we read about her as a pioneer. And unfortunately, she moves back to Italy in the year 1915. We don't know the reasons why she went back to Turin. But in Turin, again, she makes lots of movies as the world agent of Helios Studios. Helios Studios have a stiff competition from Milano Films of Italy. And there was one person by name Gustavo Lambertau. And this Gustavo Lambertau is deriding her, saying that she's making cheap imitation movies of the Dante's Inferno. Dante's Inferno is said to be the oldest available movie that we can see. And this movie, Dante's Inferno, it was made by both the companies, by Milano Films and also by Helios Studios, which Mrs. Klug headed. And she was, she was bombarded by Gustavo. It was a man's world, totally a man's world, and a woman to sit there and win in a production and a distribution company as its global leader is something really amazing that this woman could do. And she had a lot of stiff competitions as another movie researcher, Vittorio Beni. Very unfortunately, this woman, she died in 1926 of cancer when she was hardly 38 years old. A very short-lived life. And that too, in Chennai, she lived for a very, very short period, say for 6 or 7 months. And this is, here you see, this is a news clipping that is from the movie world, where she says, Mrs. Klug-Schultz returns to Italy during a short stay in the city. This city, I think this is probably New York where she had stayed. And it says that she was a bright and active young girl. She came all the way from Italy and took over the American film market. That's what has been mentioned about this. And again, you can see here, it mentions recently Miss Klug had become the wife of a successful young engineer, Mrs. Schultz. I presume this Mr. Schultz must be the person who owned the Schultz Studios. So probably she owned the, she married the proprietor of the Schultz Studios. So what happened to the place that she ran this movie theater? The place is still very much alive and active. It is the same building number 16 in Popham's Broadway, now number 145 Prakasam Sale, which we now call the Sukrita Lakshmi Vilasa Sabha. The Sukrita Lakshmi Vilasa Sabha has been functioning from the same complex from the year 1944. I was able to grab a picture of this place. It's very much still alive and active in Popham's Broadway. So this was the place where South India's first movie, permanent movie theater, functioned for more than 7 months. And the person who ran the entire show was this beautiful young woman, 23-year-old Frida Schultz. Over to the second woman of the day, Dame Dr. Mary Ann Duncombe Scarling. Enough has been said about Dr. Scarling, but still I want to highlight some points about Mrs. Scarling that we miss. She was born in 1845. We all know she was born in a very normal family. She married a person by name Scarlib when she was 19 years old, and she came in from England to Madras because her husband Scarlib was working as a barrister in Madras High Court. So when this woman came to Madras, her primary dream was to run a household. She had three children. The couple had three children. They lived in various locations in Madras, in Spartank Road, and then in Beads Garden, in Leyland's Garden, she stayed. And then suddenly, there's one family friend, Joseph Fair, who wants her to review a magazine, to read and review a magazine called the Medical Jurisprudence Review. And when she reviews the magazine, she comes across curious cases of obstetric and gynecology problems. And then she has a very sad personal experience. One of her house servants, he is a Muslim by birth and his wife is following strictly the Muslim gosha. And when she, when she's pregnant and when she begets a child, it becomes very difficult. It is a tough pregnancy for her. And when a male doctor is summoned, a European doctor is summoned, she refuses to take treatment from the doctor, bolts herself in a room, and she dies. And this incident, it makes a lasting impression on Scarlib, who now makes it a point that she wants to study medicine so she can save a lot of local Indian women who were dying. So she went and met this remarkable person, met Surgeon General Balfour, and she asks his permission to intern in a hospital. And she's given permission to work in the lying-in hospital for a couple of months, and she starts working there. And because she finds it very difficult to take care of her children while she's working there, she sends her children back to Ooty, where the children are taken care of by her own parents. They stay there, and she stays back in the city, shunting back and forth between the lying-in hospital and her home. And then she works under Major Surgeon Major Cockrell for another year. And then she meets Lord Hobart, then the governor of Madras, and Balfour. And she keeps on pressurizing them to allow women to learn medicine. Until 1875, women were not allowed into the Madras Medical College. And in 1875, she gets permission for women to enter Madras Medical College for the first time in the year 1875 to do their licentiate in medicine. There is another interesting person here by name Dr. A.M. Branfort. And Branfort refuses to teach the women, saying that he's going to teach only the men in the class. And as women, they can sit on the sidelines and listen to what is being told in the class. He's very clear that he's not going to explain anything, as he's not going to teach anything to the students. But when people with leprosy, when they find patients with leprosy and syphilis coming in, then he gives, he gives assignments to the women to come and attend the patients. And slowly, these four women, four European women, remarkably, they learned the ropes by just observing what is being done. And in the year 1878, they complete their licentiate in medicine. We don't have any idea about what the other three men did, but then what Mary Scarlip did was, again, a wonderful thing, because she knew that with the licentiate, she could not continue working here. And so she sails to England to learn medicine, to properly do her medicine degree. So she sails back to England with her children. And there in London School of Medicine, she studies. She joins there in the year 1878. And in 1882, she completes her medicine degree with a gold medal in obstetrics. And when she gets her gold medal, she's invited by our own Lady with the Lamp, Florence Nightingale. The two women meet each other and they both talk to each other. And it is at the behest of Florence Nightingale that Mary Scarlip meets Queen Victoria. And why does she even meet Queen Victoria? Because these two women think that the women of Madras need a separate hospital for themselves, because they do not want to take treatment from the male doctors who are offering them support and help. And so they meet. I think Florence Nightingale could not meet on behalf of Florence Nightingale with a person called Henry Acland. With his help, Mary Scarlip meets Queen Victoria and asks if they can start a separate hospital for women in Madras, and she gets a permission from the Queen to open it. And there starts the work of the Caste and Gosha Hospital, which slowly takes form, takes shape. And it is largely supported by Lady Grant Duff, who gives them money, and then they collect public subscription. And the Queen Victoria Caste and Gosha Women's Hospital starts in Nungambakkam Moor's Garden in the year 1883. So that, you see, that's her picture, caricature of hers, which was drawn at a very later stage. So her work in Madras was backbreaking. When she came back to Madras, her typical day would start at 5:30 in the morning. From 5:30 to 7, she would do house visits of Gosha and caste women's houses. From 7 a.m. to 11 a.m., she used to meet OP patients, at least 70 people. And then from 12 to 1, she teached at the MMC. 1 to 4, she used to meet patients, OP patients at home. 5 to 8, she met the European patients in their own houses. And then dinner, and then bed. And then in case of any emergency, she'll be called right back to the hospital in the night. So right from 5:30 in the morning, this woman worked for the local women that we call, or the native women of Madras. And she was fatigued. She had done a lot of overwork, and her health took a heavy toll. And so she requested, she needed assistance. And there's another doctor, good lady doctor by the name Mary Pelthorp, who comes in here. And then she hands over reins to Pelthorp and she sails back to England. In what condition? She's not even able to walk when she gets back to England. She thinks that she's going back to England to die, having served in India until 1887. So more than 7 years she has worked here. She started the Caste and Gosha Hospital. She had given it a life. And in 1890, the government gave it a permanent space in Triplicane, where the hospital still now functions. Now we call it the Government Kasturba Gandhi Hospital. And again, when she went back to England, she regained her health. She completes her MD, her MS, and she's the first English woman to do that. And she lived for 40 more years in England. She continued to write. She was an avid feminist. She wrote a lot of books, A Woman's Words to Women, The Mother's Guide, The Seven Ages of Women, The Hope of the Future, some of the few books that I can mention about. And here she writes in her book called The Reminiscences. In this book, she mentions why she did not want to take up the work of missionary. See, she writes, "I did not think that it would be right for me to take advantage of the doctor's position of confidential advisor and friend to do any definite missionary work. Not being a missionary, I thought such a line of conduct would be dishonest. My aim was to live the gospel, although I could not preach it verbally." Now, I find a lot of people, you know, saying missionaries came here to convert people. The prime aim of the missionary was to convert people. We also have people like Mary Scarlib who wanted to really contribute something to the Tamil society and not to convert people. Even though she had the chance to convert so many people, she writes very clearly that it is not her job to keep converting people. So she was made the dame of the British Empire in 1926. That's why we call her the dame. And she died on November 21, 1930. And here is an obituary that was carried by the New York Times. It mentions very clearly, Mary Scarlib, physician, is dead. Pioneer women doctor in India. She succumbs at 85 in London and she began her medical course at 33. She had lectured in Madras and she procured many reforms for the native women. So something that she has done for the Indian women, something that she has done for the women of this presidency, something that this woman had done for you and me, finds a mention in the New York Times, whereas we have totally forgotten who Dr. Mary Scarlib was. So over to the next person, Florence Swainson. Swainson and I, we have a very interesting connection because I couldn't find even a picture of her when I was trying to read about her and when I was trying to write about her. So Florence Swainson, missionary, she is a qualified nurse and she is sent by the CEZMS, the Zenana Mission, in the year 1882 to work in Amritsar. And from Amritsar, she is transferred to Palayamkota to Saratakar in 1889. And when she works in Palayamkota, she meets a 10-year-old girl by name Pakyam. Pakyam comes to Swainson and she sees that Swainson is teaching the regular kids. And Pakyam is very interested to read and write. She comes and asks her to teach her. And Swainson is totally taken aback because this young girl, 10-year-old girl, she is impaired. She cannot read, she cannot listen, nor can she speak. She is, she has a hearing impairment. She also has a speaking impairment. So how do we teach someone who can't speak? How do we teach someone who can't hear? So that is a big problem for Swainson. And Swainson really thinks about these deaf and dumb people in India. The neglected deaf and dumb children, especially those who were living in orphanages. She's worried about those people. And she starts a school with three children, with Pakyam and two other young children who are orphans who come and ask her to give them education in the same Saratakar campus where she was working. And she writes that in a report that is given to the missionary report, she writes, in 1895, there are 2 lakh mute and deaf people in India and something should be done to take care of these people. The picture that you're seeing right here on the screens is a class which is being taken in Florence Swainson's school in Palayamkota in the year 1895. You can see a few children who are sitting there and standing there. And there is an Indian teacher who is teaching them English and Tamil. So how do you teach English and Tamil to the children? You see, pa and p, va and v. So they teach both the letters together using signs of both the languages. You can see the children with their fingers and signs. So that we call dactylology, talking through signs. And she also teaches the children lip reading. And she teaches the Indian teachers to carry on the baton, to continue teaching the deaf and dumb children. And she gathers some money in the year 1897. She moves the school from Saratakar campus to a new campus, which is opposite to the Palayamkota jail. And that is 14 acres of land, which is given to her by a doctor by name Dhanakoti Raju for 4,500 rupees. And that campus is very much alive and active even today, doing the same service to the deaf and dumb children of this presidency. In 1901, she got government recognition for the work that she has done. And from a lot of grants she's getting from countries like England and Canada, she opens up sick rooms, hostels, kitchens, storerooms, mainly from the funds and the donations. And she thinks that merely education is not enough to change these children, to change their lives for the better. And so she teaches them carpentry, tailoring, bookbinding, printing, composing, basket making, mat weaving, gardening, cooking, folk arts, and even kummi is being taught to these deaf and dumb children by her. And she also teaches them weaving. Their weaving was so famous that the famed Harvey Mills, they were giving them, supplying them yarn. And these children, they were weaving their rugs. And one of their rugs won a prize at the Lucknow exhibition, which happened in the year 1902. Imagine deaf and dumb children weaving rugs and winning a prize in the All India competition. And in 1896, she starts a women's industrial class, also empowering the women from a place like Palimpkota. And she also starts a branch industrial school in a place called Sudeseshapuram near Palimpkota. And she also receives fund from the Silent Service Guild. She opens branch schools in Madras and Tiruvalla. So this building that you're seeing is very much now alive in Palimpkota. I was able to visit this place recently for some other book work that I am doing, a research work. And this building was very much built in the same year, 1902, when the school came up. I was also able to find finally a color picture or an illustration of Florence Swainson, who was the founder and principal of the deaf and dumb schools of Madras, of Tiruvalla, and of Palimpkota. The moment I saw this picture, I think it was one of the most fabulous goosebumps moment that I felt. This building is also a part of the deaf and dumb school in Palimpkota that was built by Swainson. Very interestingly, there are rooms that are being donated by a lot of people across the religious circles. You know, that you see here, the room, it was given in commemoration of the coronation darbar of King George V, the Emperor of India, and it was a gift by Medai Dalavai Thirumalai Pamudaliyar in the year 1911. So she could collect funds. She could also collect donations from people like Thirumalai Pamudaliyar. So now we see that the women, the missionary women who worked, who came here as people of today will say to convert people, they were right back then cutting across the religion. They were able to support and help each other in such good deeds. The next one, again, this inscription is in the same school. This is a plaque which is erected by Tina Sthithapati, who's the loyal zamindar of Singambatti, to commemorate the coronation day of King George V, in memory of R.W. Ash Esquire, the collector of Thinaveli, who lost his life in the district, dated June 17, 1911. I was really surprised when I saw this plaque, because we all know Ash was one of those persons who was murdered by the nationalists, that we would call. If Ash was some kind of a villain, I really wonder how someone would donate a room in a deaf and dumb school in memory of a person who was killed by a nationalist for his so-called imperialistic behavior. I'm totally surprised by this plaque. So Ash is someone whom I think we should read and reread in history. And what you're seeing here is the CSI Deaf and Dumb School, very much here in Santhom, a building that is led to rot here. That is what I would exactly say. The CSI diocese has control of this particular building. This building has been functioning right from 1913 as a school. Because that is when Swainson, she gives a request to the government asking if she can run a school in this building, which has been vacated as Beats. This initially was functioning as Beats School. And when Beats moved to a location opposite to this place, she gives a letter to the government asking if she can open a school for the deaf and dumb children of Madras. And very much the government gives her permission to open the school. And she starts the school here. This building also belonged to Dr. Dhanakoti Raju, the same person who had sold her the place where she started her school in Palimpottai. And this bungalow was one of his residential bungalows. And when Dhanakoti Raju died, probably his family donated it or gave it to the Swainson. And when Swainson started the school is still very much functioning, but unfortunately not in this campus. They say that this campus is unsafe to keep children in it. And so they have shifted to a new campus, which is nearby. We find that Swainson moved to Madras, moved out of Madras in the year 1919 owing to her ill health. She had put in 37 years of service in the Madras presidency, mostly served the poor, orphan, deaf, and dumb children of the Madras presidency. Catherine Frances Ling. Again, this was also a very interesting story because mostly when we talk about the women missionaries, this woman missionary in particular, she was a person who worked all through her life in the Nilgiris, the place the Todas lived, the Toda land. She's a missionary who worked together hand in hand with the Todas. If you see that the Toda people have changed a lot, most of them have changed to Christianity, most of them have got education, most of them have equipped themselves so well these days, it's because of this one particular woman by name Catherine Frances Ling. These two people, Reverend Marieke and Reverend Metz, they had worked for more than 25 years in the Nilgiris, but they were very unsuccessful. They could not even convert one single person to Christianity when they worked there. But this person, Frances Ling, she came to Nilgiris in 1890. She came as the head of the Zanana mission. She started two schools and a girls' hostel. She started a new Mohammedan girls' school near the Ooty market. The school still functions there in 1887. And she starts working with the Todas. The Todas generally had an animosity towards the Christian missionaries because they thought that the missionaries were changing their way of life, which is, of course, to an extent true. And she was not able to convert anybody. But then she was worried about the Toda people because they had a lot of their lifestyle was totally different to the normal European lifestyle that we would call. They had polyandry, there was wife lifting, there was lack of education, female infanticide was there, and there was a very pathetic deflowering ritual that happened with the Todas, which this woman was particularly against. And they also had a pastoral life, making it impossible to give them proper education. And so she begins working with them and she finds that the buffalo is the heart of the Todas. It is the heart of the Toda culture. And so she tries to extricate themselves from the buffalo culture. She tries to talk with the Todas and she learned the Toda dialect using Tamil through one of the students who was the student of the Basel mission. And then she does, she attends an exam in the Toda dialect, which is made by Walker of Tinalveli, Bishop Walker of Tinalveli. And she passes the exam. She learns the Toda language. And she starts translating the Bible stories and gospels in Toda, in the Toda Tamil language. And she even translates the Gospel of Mark in the year 1894, which gets published in 1897. And she starts the first school for Todas in a place called Susgandhi near Paikara in the year 1893. And slowly the Todas, they send in their children. And she starts two more schools within the Sholas, Governor Shola, because she finds that the Todas keep moving. They're a pastoral community. And so when as and how they move, she starts the schools wherever these children go. There is no fee. She offers free clothes. They're given free accessories to learn. And they also learn Christian catechism along with math and the language. And in 1904, finally, she achieves success when a person by name Kishkar, he converts to Christianity. He is the first Toda to convert to Christianity. And slowly they start to build churches. Moving letter to these people, asking them if they can, if she can come back to them. Even if 12 men try to do the work of that one old woman did, it has become impossible. Even if 12 men look at the work that one woman looked at, it has become impossible. The crowd, they call themselves the Christian Todas, that gathered are rising up to migrate, each to a different direction. There is no relative at all to help us. We have become like children on the lap. We have become like calves in the calf pen. And when she receives the moving letter, this lady, when she goes back to England, she comes back to Nilgiris. She comes back here, she returns here, and she introduces cows to the Todas and extricates them from buffalo rearing. And she also starts a dispensary exclusively for Toda people. She writes this book, Dawn in Toda Land, about her experiences with the Todas. And she has written a moving letter in a missionary report. She writes to the missions, to the Zanana missions, that she would send a special message to the girls of England to come and help in the work that she is doing in India. She writes that The setting free of millions of little girls in India from the bondage of child marriage by the coming into force of the Sharda Act. And this very day, its echoes were heard in the collector's office at Kootakamam, where a committee meeting of the Toda Welfare Committee was taking place. Could it not be made applicable to rescuing little Toda girls of 12 from the most degrading ceremony that surely man ever conceived? She's so concerned about the Toda little girls that she wants the Sharda Act and its benefits to be extended to the poor Toda girls. And this woman, Margaret Bushby Lascelles Cockburn, it's not Cockburn, we pronounce it Cockburn. Miss Cockburn is the daughter of the collector of Nilgiris, M.D. Cockburn, and she is a great friend of A.O. Hume. We know Mr. A.O. Hume as an avid ornithologist. He has written a wonderful book on the nests and eggs of Indian birds, Alan O. Hume. And Hume nurtured this lady. And in this book that he has written, in the nests and eggs of Indian birds, he has so many times mentioned about M.B. Cockburn, who is the daughter of M.D. Cockburn, the collector of Salem and Nilgiris. We also see that this family, they come and settle down in Nilgiris in the year 1855 at a place called Hope Park in Kotagiri. And if we see that Miss Ling had worked with the Todas, we find that Cockburn had worked with the, interestingly, with the Badagas. Her work was mostly with the Badagas. And in 1861, we find that she converts two Badagas who are their servants to Christians. And she invites the Basil Mission to set up work in Kotagiri. The painting that you see here is a wonderful painting that is done by her. She is a beautiful artist. She has made a lot of wonderful paintings. We'll be coming to that later. And this Basil Mission Needy Church, this picture that you see here is one taken recently. This is the same church that she helped construct. And this is an old picture of that church. This Needy Church was one of those churches that was constructed by her. And she starts an orphanage. She sets up the first orphanage in Kotagiri. And she also runs exclusive schools for the Badagas in Kotagiri. And when rock pipit, there is a unique bird called the rock pipit, which is named after her, called Anthus Cockburnii, which was earlier named that way. And then it is not anymore. They have now changed it. You can find the name Anthus Cockburnii here. This Cockburnii is known but our Miss M.D. Cockburn. These are the paintings. All her paintings have been compiled and under this Nilgiri Birds and Miscellaneous. This is a wonderful collection of her paintings that she has done. She has painted the birds, the trees and the flowers of Nilgiris mostly, the eggs, the feathers, and her whole collection of butterfly paintings. She has done marvelous collection of butterflies and all of them are right now with the National History Museum in the UK. She's also done the Nilgiri plates. The Nilgiri plates also hold her paintings. And the entire collection of hers was bequeathed to the NHM in the year 2002. And in Nilgiri Gazetteers, there's one person by name W. Francis in the year 1908, who mentions very clearly about this particular woman. And what he mentions about this lady is that she was the person who introduced tea in Kotagiri. It was not any other person, but this M.D. Cockburn. In 1859, she started working with the Chinese prisoners of war. And in a place called this Naduvattam Estate, which is near the Chinese jail then, they started a small estate. The Arvenu is the name of the place. And they planted the first tea saplings of Kotagiri here in the year 1859. And the Alport's Tea Estate, which later changed to Alport's Tea Estate, it is the first tea estate, which was established under the leadership of this remarkable woman. And there is this family itself is a very wonderful family because we all know this Catherine Falls in Kotagiri. Most of us would have seen this. This falls is named after M.D. Cockburn's mother, Catherine. Her paintings are there in three volumes of Flora and Fauna of Nilgiris with NHM. The Needy Church of Kotagiri, the Tea of Kotagiri, and also all that remains is this grave of hers in the Needy Church. She died in the year 1928. And I think this is the last person that I'll be talking today. Fanny Emily Penny. We all have spoken a lot about Frank Penny, who he wrote a wonderful book, The Churches of Madras. But his wife, Fanny Emily Penny, most of her work has not been spoken about. She has done illustrations for her husband's book. Born in 1847, she married Reverend Frank Penny in the year 1877, and she moved immediately to Madras. And when Frank wrote the church in Madras, they both stayed in Nungambakkam High Road and they had close contact with most of the Eurasians here. She witnessed a lot of festivals. She had chronicled the festivals that have been celebrated in Madras presidency with pomp and show, including those in Kanchipuram and Trichinopoly. This is one thing that has been written about Mark Twain, about the Indian traditions and customs. You know, he has written the foreword of the book, The Coromandel Coast, by her, F.E. Penny. Here you can see, On the Coromandel Coast is the book written by her. And she has also written the Southern India. You find a lot of paintings that have been done by Lady Lolly in this book. And the description is totally by F.E. Penny. And here she writes about the Muslim women of Triplicane. Very interestingly, she writes, whether it be the wife of a rich trader or a journeyman tailor, she may not pass the threshold of the street door unless she's closely veiled. Her only means of exercise and of breathing fresh air is in the small backyard with its high walls, excluding every other sight but the blue sky and the tall coconut palm that grows in her neighborhood's yard or her own. She lives within the sound of the sea, but her eyes have never rested upon it. So she writes such about the Muslim women who lived in and around Triplicane. And she also has written about the Devadasis of Madras presidency. She writes, now mark the topsy-turvydom of Hinduism. The Hindu honors the temple girl as a daughter of the deity. So great an honor it is regarded that the goldsmiths and weavers of Trichinopoly devote the eldest daughter of the family to the temple service of Srirangam. The girls are handed over young and are taught in the temple to read and write, sing and dance and dress themselves daintily, to don their hair with flowers and wear their jewels with dignity. After the ceremony, when they say the ceremony of their marriage with the god, they're ready to ply their trade with the devout worshippers who attend the temple. Their earnings go to swell the temple revenue. A village temple has no women attached to it. So she writes about the plight of the Devadasis of Madras presidency. And she also writes about the Paria women. I don't know if it will be the right term that we can use now, but then that was the term that she has written by that period. She has written a Paria women and she writes that they wear no ornaments, not because she is poor, but because she is a widow. She offers an interesting insight of an European woman about the women of Madras presidency. And we also see that when she moves to Nilgiris, when we find that Frank Penny is transferred in 1888 to the Nilgiris, there she meets novelist Bithia Mary Crocker. Yes, someone had mentioned about Crocker now. Yes. And there she's inspired to write English novels in Indian setting. She writes 30 books in all. And this book, The Lady of the Rifle, is one of her books. And after 25 years in India, she leaves for Ealing in England. And she dies in 1939 in England. So that's all I think about the day. We have spoken about five such remarkable women of the Madras presidency today. I'm so sorry about the technical glitch that happened. It should not have happened. I'm extremely sorry what happened in between. So thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity of addressing people on Madras Day, which is a very, very rare honor. Thank you so much, Shashi sir, for this wonderful opportunity.
Thank you, Nivedita. That was, of course, a lovely presentation. As somebody has mentioned in the chat box, all these glitches will happen. We are living in a whole new world and we are still trying to figure ourselves, ways and means to connect. So these things happen. The only problem was patience. People must develop patience and wait. And good, you got back with us. There are some questions now for you in the chat box. Can you see the chat box?
Yes, I can.
Reading it out? So why don't you answer them?
Yes, definitely. I can see lovely presentation so far. Thank you so much. That's by Rebecca. Thank you so much. And one Mr. Ravi has said, Penny has written a lot about Madras. Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Yes, she has written. Crocker has also wrote a book on Madras. Yes, she also has written. And I'm really thinking why when people, when we take H.D. Love's book as a ready reckoner on Madras, when we take Glenn Barlow's book on a ready reckoner of Madras, why don't we look at Madras from a women's angle, especially with books from people like Crocker and from Fanny Penny? I think, thank you so much, Ravi sir. Yes, we should be looking at this angle also, the European women and what they have written about the presidency. Thank you. Any other questions from anyone?
No, there are some questions above, Nivedita. Can you scroll up and you'll see there are questions on electricity. Okay.
I'm not able to see.
Okay, I'll read them out. From Mr. Murali here. He's put the first question actually saying, this is about electricity and reliable electricity was available in 1913 in Madras. He's asking, based on Mrs. Klug's advertisement. But according to, he also puts the Tangedgore link, that is the Tamil Nadu Electricity Development Corporation. He's saying, I was wondering what kind of electricity production existed in Madras in 1913. And to his question, somebody, Mr. Ravi has said, I think private enterprises had their own means of power supply.
Yes, sir.
Long
yes,
before
sir.
Corporation began. I think that's yes, the sir. Answer there.
Yes, yes. Ravi has the right answer. Yes, sir. Absolutely right. Because we know that electricity was already prepared by the private distributors. Even as far as Karaikudi and Devakote, they also had their own electricity before the government could start supplying electricity to people.
Yeah. Any questions from anyone? You can actually unmute and you can ask her because if you want to. My question to you, Nivedita, is also one of the things that I have been saying earlier, that we've listened to you talking about various people, five women here, being Madam Scali, Ben Florence Swanson, and Catherine Francis. How difficult was it for you when you were researching on these people? I mean, you've done a lot of original research, and original research is something that you don't find so much these days. Perhaps you needn't divulge the sources, but certainly if you've been to, let's say, the Tamil Nadu archives in Egmo, if you have, or somewhere else, how difficult did you find researching on these people and getting inside and getting started?
Yeah, I think this information or the source is really very difficult to get, Shashi sir. The problem is that when you go into archives, they ask if you have a proper ID card. Which university do I work with? Am I a research scholar? Do I have a proper ID card? Or if I work with some organization, will I be producing my employee card? Being an independent researcher, it's very, very difficult because I do not have one. I don't have any ID. So whatever information that is available, I think the internet is a very, very big boon that has been given to us, right on a platter, served to us on a platter. So internet has been my major source. But then I don't confine to the internet alone for gathering data about women. As you have seen, the information about Swainson and all, I could find only because I could go in person to the Deaf and Dumb School in Palimpota so that I could have a glimpse of a picture at least. It was very difficult to get her access to her picture, and someone told in my friends list that there is a picture of hers in the Deaf and Dumb School. So I went all the way from here to Palimpota looking for her picture. So when I went looking for a picture, I found Ash's plaque, and then you know the story, the rest of it. So I made a lot of interesting discoveries only after traveling a lot. Otherwise, I think gaining access to sources is a very, very difficult thing, especially for independent researchers. The system doesn't support independent researchers. It's very difficult.
Also, I think it requires a lot of funding if you're traveling, because a lot of information might be even overseas. It might not be in India,
Yes, sir.
So
definitely.
I think
definitely.
That's also a major problem. You might want to research, but you cannot go travel to a place because it costs money. I think that's also an sort of impediment.
But, yeah, if I get proper funding, probably I would be really interested to travel to all the places where these women live, where they work, where they were buried, meeting and talking to their family. All that would be really wonderful to understand, to get an insight into what an European woman who came to India exactly felt like and what they actually lived like. It's very difficult because, as you said, funding is definitely going to be a problem. Without funding, I don't think I could have done much.
There is a hotel in Yerkad. I'm not able to get the name straight away, but I think it was run by Club Mahindra or is still being run by Club Mahindra. There are some old, facts about a lady called Henrietta who actually, gave the place for that estate and things like that. So we have a lot of these nuggets, actually gems, but, nobody knows.
Sir. They're all just nuggets. You have only one or two lines about these women. Only when you sit to work and you start researching more about these women, I think you can get some information. The information about Mrs. Klug, I think right from Smuteyasa's period, everybody has repeated again the same two sentences that he has said. Nobody has got down to the ground and searched for Mrs. Klug, actually. It took me just 1 week to find out who she was and to get a picture of her.
Are you planning a book on what you presented to us today, this evening, about, let's say foreign women in Madras or women's contribution to Chennai, something like that?
I think I should be writing.
You should.
Yes. And I think I should also be writing it in English, because most of the people whom I met recently, off late, they've been asking me to write in English because it's very difficult. It's a totally different kind of audience to whom it goes. So I seriously think I should write in English.
I think if you do that, Mr. Mutha will be very proud. And we owe a little bit of what we celebrate during Madras Day and Madras Week to him.
Definitely.
So, is there any question from anyone else? Rebecca has a question for you. Yes.
Hi, lovely presentation. Thank you so much. All your effort. I was just overwhelmed by all the women and all the presentation of it.
Thank you so much, Rebecca.
I have a very small question. It may be wrong, but I'll ask anyway. I was just wondering, when you're talking about foreign women, where do Rukmani Devi, Arundale, and the lady Annie Besant, where do they all figure? Are they in your list? Or because, see, you can't talk about all the women in such a, a one-hour doesn't do
of justice. Course. So about Annie Besant, very good question that.
Figure in your list of foreign women who have, helped Madras.
Yeah. Yes. I think a lot has been said about Annie Besant and Rukmani Devi Arundale. Don't you agree? Lot has been spoken about them. Books have been written on them. People have, talked about them. They've written about them. What about these unknown and unsung women? I want to write about those women who have been in the shadows. It's really something to bring those women out from the shadows, throw them out in the open, and say that these women also contributed something to our society.
Fantastic. Because, honestly, I haven't come across these names. Like, when you were talking about Klug and all, I was like, wow. So much has been done. So
yeah.
Thank you so
much. Thank you.
And I am waiting for your book to come out.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Well, I think here, Nivedita, you could also just, repeat what we were speaking about earlier, about the need for people to get, more interested in their surroundings, and for especially researchers to do this bit, instead of macro. That's exactly what Rebecca is saying, but you can probably say something about it.
Yeah. So what I would love to say in this instance is that people, when they talk about history, it's always about history at a macro level. We talk about world history, we talk about European history, we talk about Indian history as a whole. What about Mylapore's history? What about Rayapuram's history? What about Rayapeta's history? And what about Kasimedu's history? Who's going to write this history? And what about the history about small communities? Say, for instance, the fisherman community, say, for instance, the sweeper community, say, for instance, the cleaner community. Every community, in fact, in Madras has its own history. And I think the history of this particular community should come from themselves. It's not our pen to write. It's not our work to write. It's their work to come out in the open and write. And I'm finding a lot of research scholars and students who are coming in to write, especially from the oppressed communities. And I would love women from the oppressed communities to come up, to open up, and to write their histories on their own from a woman's perspective. What I am finding, we find a lot of Dalit movies coming, say, for instance, Sarvata or say Varachennai or whatever be the movies, it is all again being said in a patriarchal male tone. And we would love to see Dalit women coming out and writing their histories from their perspective.
Yeah, do you want to share that secret about your book on the Dalits now, or should you just keep quiet?
No, not now.
All right, not now. Okay, sorry.
I'm working on a translation. I'm working on a translation.
All right. Yes. Okay, we'll switch quickly to a question. There's one question from here. Arokya has a question for you. She says, as an academician, I appreciate and I'm amazed with the amount of fieldwork, etc. you do. Of course, we'll appreciate your work. So well done. She asked, what kind of response and treatment do you think these women would have faced? These women would have faced both from the natives and more from their own people. Any idea?
From the natives, I think they would have looked at them in amazement mostly.
because we always have this fad for white-skinned people. We look up at them with amazement. So I don't think normal women or the Indian women would have looked up at them with some kind of sense of amazement. But about the other European women, I think they had a lot of camaraderie within themselves. They held each other, they helped each other in different difficult situations. They had this camaraderie, they wrote to each other. As we see, they could pull funds from different associations. We can find a lot of English villages contributing to the temples here, to contributing to the churches here. So that kind of camaraderie was always there among the European women. But when it comes to the relationship between Indian women and the European women, I think we don't have a proper data to say that. I'm reading a book called Meenakshi's Memoirs. That's again a very interesting book. If someone can gain access to that book, please do read the book. It says about how Dalit oppressed woman from Black Town, how she learned English and how she moved with a European woman. It gives amazing insight into how Indian women looked upon the European women.
All right. So all that I will reveal now is that you're working on a book of translations and it will be out by the year end or early next year. So that's,
yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Your words to aspiring young researchers and people who are passionate about heritage, not necessarily Madras, but any city, any place, what would you tell them?
I don't get you. Can you come again, please?
What would you tell young people who who are concerned about heritage, who are concerned about preservation, conservation, who want to do their bit, who want to write perhaps, or who want to do something? What is your advice to them? Because you've now reached a stage where you are the holding the baton from the senior people and you're leading from the front. So what is your advice to the younger guys? I mean, what do they do? Because they don't have anyone to show them the way.
Yeah, I don't think I'm that qualified to give advice. But again, if asking for my two cents, I would really say that women should come up to write the history of Madras. Because we have a lot of other perspectives being written. I don't think anybody can write anything more than what Asmodeus has written, more than what Sriram has done. So I think there is a different perspective that you have to put. I think people should get down on the streets, talk to people, and write history through the eyes of the society. History is not something about merely dates and places. It's more about people. So we have to talk to the people. There are a lot of oral histories that have remained undocumented, especially in North Madras. So when you look at the researchers who are working, to the north of Paris, I think the numbers would be, a handful. You don't even know the number of people who work north of Madras. So I want people to move more to localities, to talk to people and start documenting everything that they find. It is not that something that is 300 years old, something that is 400 years old, only that is history. No, anything that happened 10 years ago is also history. And it is also imperative that you record that in case if it has made a change in someone's life. That is history. So the young people, the young blood, I think they should also get interested in searching for their roots rather than, hanging on to their branches. The roots are where our eyesight should be on the roots and not on the branches.
A couple of questions quickly. I think these are from students. I'm not sure, but there's one.
Yep.
Tadeen Firoz who asks, this is an obvious question. Do you feel we have something to learn from these European women? There's another question from Madhumati who says, you mentioned about the weird customs of the tribals before Francis came by. She was able to convert them. Was it just the education that enticed them?
Yes. Coming to the first question, your first question was that what should we learn from this European and English women? I think we should learn empathy. Empathy is what we totally lack. When someone, someone dies of hunger, when someone dies right in front of our eyes, we just, as the citizens of 2021, we just move away. We keep away from problems, but that is not what these women did. They came into the vortex of their problems. They tried to find solutions and they tried to do something for the women who were in no way related to them. They came 3,000 miles away from 3,000 miles away and they did something for the people of this land, even though they were never concerned, the people of the land were never concerned about the Europeans who came here. All they wanted was, to make some money, to make their living, But these women, despite the difficulties that they face, they try to do something for the Indian women. And that is what we should always keep in mind. This empathy is something that is missing in most of the younger people these days. We should have this empathy. That's the answer to the first question. And to the second question, I think someone asked about, what was the question, Shashi? I'm sorry.
No. She was asking about the weird customs of the tribals before Francis came. And yes, she's asking whether it was just education that enticed them.
Absolutely. I won't say that it was just education, because when the women bring the women out of their own misery, I think, more people get attracted and come. I would like to say there is one more instance of how women supported each other. There was one woman by name Martha Malt. Martha Malt is the mother-in-law of Robert Caldwell. And Malt was the person who introduced a dress called the Kuppayam to the people of Travancore Presidency. When they started a school in Nagarkoil, she brought in slave girls and offered them Kuppayam or a dress to wear in the top. We all know that, in earlier days, you might be very well aware of that, Shashi. People from the Ilava community and the other communities, they were not allowed to wear their Kuppayams or their blouses. And that was allowed by the Christian missionary to the girls who came and who studied with them. And this Kuppayam brought about a huge revolution, and people converted en masse to Christianity because their women could cover themselves up. And that was that brought a major change down south. That is how most of the people, as you say, in Nagarkoil or in Tirunelveli or in Tuticorin district, they got educated mostly because of this Martha Malt and her missionary work. And that was possible because they offered a simple blouse to the girls to wear. So I think education is something that the missionary women gave. Of course, they converted people. I don't have a second opinion at all on that. They converted people, but still they gave the women a proper, decent living.
Anush Priya from WCC has a question. She says, hello, just the last two questions, I think. Priya from WCC says, you've mentioned foreign women in other fields. Could you say anyone from the administrative field who served in Madras?
Field.
The question is not very clear. I think she refers to people, you women who you've served outside the health sector, perhaps. I'm not sure, but I think that's it.
Yeah, I don't think we could find anyone. I think when she means the administrative sector, she should have meant something like the civil service or something like that. I don't think we had women collectors, or I don't think we had women working in that administrative area. Very limited women worked in that way.
This again is a general sort of question. Madhumati again, she says, what do you think are the major differences that would come when there is a feminine perspective to history? Will it highlight the plight more than you think it would be or do you think it would be subjective?
No. So it depends on how a person sees that. Most of the men will not agree, or they may not agree with what the women say, because a woman's perspective is totally different from a man's perspective. I'm able to appreciate these women. I'm able to hold these women aloft because I see from a woman's perspective how difficult it is to uproot yourself from one place to 3,000 miles away, away from the climate that you're accustomed to, away from the customs and traditions that you're accustomed to a totally new place, and play a very important part in a place where you come and settle down. But a man's perspective might not be the same. He may simply say, she just came and she married the person. She had no other option. So she came to this land. She had no time. She had a lot of time in her hand. She wanted to do something. So she started school. So she started to educate people. No, that will be a man's perspective. I think both are different. Again, it depends, subjective or not subjective. It depends on a person who views it.
Yeah, all right. And the final one, we have Rebecca here, but she's put it down here. She asked you to recommend some books about Devadasis.
I think the best book that one can read about Devadasis is Lotus Buds, a book by Amy Carmichael. Again, I missed out Amy Carmichael today because most of us know about Amy Carmichael and her work with the Devadasi women. She has saved more than 1,000 young children from becoming Devadasis in the South. She had set up a home in a place called Donavur. There's a huge orphanage that still functions there, a very much functional orphanage. She had saved 1,000 such children from this clutches of this Devadasi system. She was called Ammai by those children. And she has written a beautiful book called Lotus Buds, where she recounts her experiences of how she and her group of ayahs or akkals, how they tried to save these children, how they paid money to buy these girl children and give them proper education in an orphanage. So lotus buds will be a most recommended thing because that's a primary source from someone who worked with the Devadasis.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
So thank you all. I think we are closing in on 8:30, and thank you all for being with us here still. Thank you, Nivedita, for that wonderful presentation. I know there were some glitches, but we all agree and we know that we have to live with these. But I think we appreciate that you took the trouble to be there and overcome the odds and still be with us. So I think hats off to you for doing it, because it's very difficult. You know, I mean, there are a lot of people who are not tech savvy or whatever, but you were there and you connected and you ensured that we went through with the show. So thank you very much for making it.
Thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. I'm always looking forward to this lecture by Press Institute because it's always something that's very close to my heart.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, that makes it more meaningful. We'll have this on YouTube, on the PII, of course, the Press Institute of India, YouTube channel. More power to you, Nivedita. I'm sure your book will come out well, and may you continue the good work that you're doing. Thank you all for being here with us tonight. On the 25th, we have a conversation with Harry McClure and others, and we will look at a slice of Anglo-Indian history connected to Madras. Thank you all very much. Good night.
Thank you so much.